In 2018, Australian entrepreneur David Griffin started a company based on a crazy idea. What if you could generate a lot of solar power in northern Australia, which has some of the strongest sunshine in the world, and sell it to Singapore, which consumes heaps of energy per person, mostly from fossil fuels, and has pretty much no space for renewables of its own? Makes sense, right? And it turns out, he's not the first person to have this type of idea. There are a lot of places around the world with few people and lots of sun and wind that we need to start using to power cities and countries far away. There's even the idea to create a kind of global supergrid, allowing us to shift loads of renewable energy from where it's abundant to where it's needed. And all you really need is a lot of very, very long cables. But we've all read the title of the video. Something went wrong with Griffin's idea. So let's look into what it was, and what it means for this ambitious vision of a world that's sharing its clean electricity. This map shows the potential solar power available around the world. And this one shows the same thing for wind. It's pretty clear that some areas get a lot more of one or both than others. So rather than only consuming that clean energy within the borders of the country producing it, it might make a lot more sense to spread it around. To share this energy, it needs to go through something called an interconnector, which is a high voltage cable that can transfer power one way, or in some cases back and forth, between the two locations.
If you have an interconnector, you can have cleaner and cheaper power coming from a neighbouring system, which the neighbouring system also benefits from as well.
That's Elizabeth Cremona, an energy and climate data analyst. She says Europe already has a pretty established system of interconnectors, which allows some countries to buy and sell clean energy based on supply and demand. And there's always room for more.
If we look at the region as a whole, you have clear areas with huge resource potential. So in the Baltics, with the Baltic Sea, you have huge offshore wind potential. Same in the Black Sea as well. And the countries that border on these areas with huge wind potential are not necessarily the ones that would actually use it. If you look at then Poland and potentially neighbouring Germany as well, huge, huge demand centres which currently are consuming a huge amount of coal, if you were to increase that regional interconnectivity, you essentially tap into these big, big sources of wind and take it to where it's actually needed. That is just in no way possible without interconnection.
This is a really big deal at this stage of the energy transition. Advocates for the shift away from fossil fuels, like the International Energy Agency, say we're getting pretty good at bringing renewable energy sources online fast. But if we can't move that electricity to where it needs to be, all that new clean energy becomes less useful. There are some groups trying to figure out how we could connect the grids of every country on Earth. The idea would be to increase regional connections enough to eventually create a supergrid, a global network of interconnectors that would let us send electricity to wherever it needs to go. But these ideas for a supergrid are still just that, ideas. There are no clear plans on how to actually make that happen on a vast scale. For the foreseeable future, it's individual projects connecting countries and regions that are starting to shape this vision of a global grid, and making renewable energy more profitable along the way.
You are encouraging, therefore, this kind of renewable investment in other countries, because the investor knows I can sell to my neighbouring country that has a big demand through this interconnector. So you create this business case for renewables in the better places.
And there's very few better places than Australia when it comes to solar.
There's a very big opportunity for Australia, and arguably responsibility for Australia, to provide power to other markets that need this power.
That's Georgie Skipper. Remember David Griffin, the guy from the beginning? Until last year, she served on the executive leadership team of his company, Suncable.
Suncable is an Australian company that was formed with the purpose of taking Australia's abundant wind and solar resource at scale to other markets in the Asia Pacific region.
And the scale of this company's plan was almost beyond belief. The idea was to build a 20 gigawatt solar farm on a massive stretch of land in Australia's Northern Territory. That's almost six times more capacity than the current biggest solar farm in the world, according to Reuters. And then, that solar farm would feed into a battery system that's more than 13 times bigger than today's biggest. To send the energy from the solar farm and batteries abroad, the company would lay three submarine cables along the 4,300-kilometre route from Darwin through Indonesian waters to Singapore, meaning they would need more than 12,000 kilometres of high-voltage cables. Today's longest existing route is around 750 kilometres. And while making all those solar panels and all those batteries would be hard, getting all that cable turned out to be even harder. And that's because many of these cable manufacturers, which are mostly based in Europe, are already too busy supplying the European market. So to get those thousands of kilometres of cable, Suncable decided to just make it themselves. they announced plans to build their own manufacturing site in Tasmania. But making these cables is not easy.
Those manufacturing plants require really considered operational capability. They're very high technology, high intensive manufacturing. And so it takes many years to build a cable manufacturing facility.
And once they get all that cable, they have to actually figure out where to put it. Submarine cable routes have to avoid any undersea volcanoes or areas more prone to submarine earthquakes. They've got to avoid shipping routes where anchors or fishing equipment could damage the cables, and big trenches that would leave the cable floating. All of that mapping, manufacturing, and planning takes a lot of money. The Australia-Asia Power Link is estimated to cost the equivalent of $23 billion. And people familiar with projects like these say the final cost will likely be a lot more. But despite the scale of these problems, SunCable was starting to make progress. In 2019, the company secured the backing of two of Australia's biggest billionaire investors, Michael Cannon-Brookes and Andrew Forrest. By the end of 2022, the company finished all the marine surveying in Australian waters, and more than two-thirds of the Indonesian section of the route had been mapped. And it had already begun talks with big cable manufacturers like Prysmian and Hellenic to help build its new factory. The plan was to start churning out cables by 2023, and eventually deliver power to Singapore by 2027. But in January of 2023, all that progress started to crumble. According to media reports, one of those big investors, Forrest, decided he wasn't happy with the direction of the project, and clashed with the other investor over what the company should be doing instead. And soon, this argument called into question one of the most fundamental parts of SunCable, the cable itself. One of the biggest challenges facing projects like SunCable's interconnector is winning the trust of all the countries involved. Each step of this extremely complicated process needs a new set of time-consuming approvals to move along. And if one part doesn't get a green tick from one side or the other, the whole thing could collapse. And countries being extremely cautious about this type of infrastructure does make a lot of sense. This isn't the first time we've shared energy along vast distances and saw the whole thing backfire. Does Nord Stream ring a bell? In 2021, the pipeline from Russia to Germany supplied around 17% of the EU's natural gas imports. When Russia shut down the pipeline, which the Kremlin says was due to a combination of Western sanctions over the invasion of Ukraine, and an attack which sabotaged the pipeline itself, Europe was scrambling to find new gas supplies to get it through the following winter. Importing a big chunk of your energy from one place, rather than producing it yourself, makes you dependent on that source, for better or worse. And for countries like Singapore, a small island nation surrounded by much bigger neighbours, that's scary, especially given what happened pretty recently. In October 2021, Malaysia decided to ban all exports of renewable energy to Singapore through the country's interconnectors, saying they needed those renewable sources themselves. This was a big issue for Singapore, which was planning to start phasing out gas, their main energy source, and use more renewables. So SunCable's plan, which the company says would provide 15% of Singapore's electricity needs, started to feel a lot riskier for Singapore. What if Australia suddenly decided that it needed to turn off the tap, for whatever reason? Or what if this huge cable going through another country's territorial waters was damaged or sabotaged? How safe could Singapore feel about switching everything over to a brand new source of energy if it had to rely on a potentially less reliable supply?
When you consider that those sorts of things can happen really quickly without warning, that creates enormous challenges for energy security. There could be cyber attacks. There could be disruptions to energy provision. It's not just as a result of a disruption from the supply side that might be related to the resource, but actually may be indeed malicious actors. And so the scale of the problem with energy security is rather large.
According to media reports, trying to get around all these concerns made Forrest question how viable the cable part of SunCable would be. He decided it'd be better to use all that solar power in a completely different way, by turning it into green hydrogen and ammonia. This is another way of moving renewable energy around that's getting a lot of attention right now. It lets you convert that clean electricity into fuel that you can ship anywhere in the world without the hassle of building a cable to connect those places. But while it has some things going for it, today's hydrogen isn't really living up to its promise because of how inefficient it is to make compared to using or sending that clean energy directly. We made a video on that here, which you should take a look at after this one. These two competing visions of what to do with SunCable's planned solar farms came to a head in January 2023, according to media reports, when the company missed two of its big milestones to get the approvals from Singapore and Indonesia needed to start laying these cables. Forrest decided that the cable strategy wasn't going to work, If they wanted his money, they'd have to switch everything over to green hydrogen and ammonia, something the other investor, Cannon Brooks, didn't agree with. The future of the project was in doubt, and without the support of both investors, the company collapsed. But that wasn't the end of the story. Eventually, Cannon Brooks outbid Forrest to take ownership of SunCable in 2023, and the Australia-Asia PowerLink project continues. But the drama did take its toll. The new plan is to start delivering power in the early 2030s, but only to Darwin, the capital of Australia's Northern Territory. The connection to Singapore is supposed to come a few years after that, if it comes at all. Because the company still has to solve the same problems of convincing all the different players involved, from governments to investors to suppliers, that this idea, which has never been done before at this scale, will work and be safe.
I'm very optimistic about the concept of what SunCable's trying to do, and then eventually a project between Australia and Singapore will be built. The question, though, is time, and how long that takes.
So what does SunCable's story mean for the vision of a global supergrid? If putting down a cable between two countries is such a struggle, connecting the entire world seems pretty far off. But it's also not science fiction. There are other really ambitious ideas to share and trade clean energy around the world. From the Xlinks Morocco-UK power project, a 4,000 kilometer long cable that, according to media reports, might even extend to Germany, to the North Sea Wind Power Hub, a plan to build wind farms on artificial islands and connect them to European countries around the North Sea. For now, a global network does remain a distant dream. But if you think all the geopolitical tensions and power games involved make it impossible, just consider, there's another global network that connects every country on Earth using submarine cables. You're using it right now to watch this video. The internet. Transporting electricity around the globe is a bit different than transmitting data, of course. Internet cables are cheaper, and the telecommunication systems they're rooted in have been around for much longer. But it can be done. And for electricity, Europe is the best example that with political will, it might even be easier than it seems. And the more of these connections we have, the more attractive it will become for other countries to join this supergrid. So let us know what you think in the comments. Where in the world do you want your green energy to come from? And make sure to subscribe to our channel. We release new videos every Friday.